For Sergio Leone, women were very important. And for him, I was very important. Everything was around her, around Jill.
Perché fra i tanti film che io ho girato, non ho trovato molti registi che amassero gli attori. Il regista vuole essere sempre lui, il despota, il padrone. Quindi l'attore così è uno che si serve di lui, uno che lavora su cose scritte, pensate dal regista. Con Sergio no, Sergio non aveva questo. Sergio era uno che amava lavorare con gli attori. Io ho sempre detto nelle interviste che mi hanno fatto di Sergio che lui lavorava come su una piramide a rovescio, cioè con la punta in basso e la base in alto. Cioè si cominciava con la scena, dopodiché lui diceva levati e si metteva lui. E lui la ripeteva arricchendola, cioè portando delle cose. Dopodiché toccava all'attore e io mi mettevo lì e la ripetevo con le sue aggiunte. E questo continuava all'infinito finché si raggiungeva una perfezione della scena. Questo era molto bello. Era molto bello, questo denota appunto l'amore che lui avesse e per il cinema e per gli attori.
Right at the very beginning, when they were making Fistful of Dollars in 1964, at one point they wanted to write the music first and cut the movie to the music, as if it was one long rock video. But they couldn't get it together. It happened too quickly. It happened too quickly with the second film. In the third film, The Good, the Bad and the Ugly, the final reels, the scene in the cemetery with Eli Wallach running round and round and round, which is very musical, and the scene of the final duel, the music was written in advance, and Leone had it in his mind, but it wasn't recorded and it wasn't played on the set. But Leone knew that he was going to have to cut to this music. But for Once Upon a Time in the West, the entire score was written before they shot a foot of film.
And the first thing he wrote with Morricone was the Jill song. Beautiful. Of course, I remember also harmonica, Brunson, fantastic.
I think Ennio Morricone and Sergio Leone had an incredible partnership in the his westerns, going back to the first. And I think that came to a culmination in Once Upon a Time in the West.
Before, there would be a dozen different themes in For a Few Dollars More, a lot of themes in The Good, the Bad and the Ugly. In Once Upon a Time in the West, there's really only about four different pieces of music, each one related to a different character.
These themes, like a Wagnerian opera, were written, one for each character, and then put them together and blend it as the characters develop relationships. All that was written before the movie was shot, and they only played it on the set.
The first thing he was doing, Sergio, was the music. And in fact, during when we were shooting, first of all, he put the song of Jill, then Chuck, and I was acting. But the music was always there during all the movie.
There's moments in this film where the interplay of music and image is so complete that it's almost uncanny. Towards the end, Henry Fonda rides back to the train to see what's happened on his grey horse, and the horse is trotting in time with Morricone's music. Leone claims that George Lucas, when he was cutting The Empire Strikes Back, had a copy of the soundtrack of Once Upon a Time in the West in the editing suite because he wanted to capture that interplay of music and image when he was making The Empire Strikes Back. I don't know if that's true or not, but it's a great story. And certainly it was a breakthrough in sound design. Leone said 40% of a movie is sound. But they had a problem with the opening sequence. And they tried some musical themes, but they didn't seem to work. They spoiled it. And one day Morricone went to a concert in Florence done by a performance artist. And it was one of these performance artists that was performing in the style of John Cage, the composer, which is that all natural sounds are music if they're played in a concert hall. You know, that it doesn't have to be pianos and musical instruments. You can have ordinary sounds, but if they're in a concert hall, all sound becomes music. And what this fellow performed was a symphony for Metal Ladder, right? So this guy comes onto the stage with a microphone and a metal ladder and does this performance with a metal ladder entirely making noises of the metal with the microphone. And Morricone went home and phoned Leone and said, why don't we do the entire sequence based on amplified natural sounds? The opening sequence, the water wheel that needs oiling, the fly that keeps buzzing, the telegraph. And then when the train comes, this deafening shriek.
We were writing, it was early 67. It was impossible to be an Italian director and not to be political. I mean, politics was in the air we were breathing, was in the spaghetti we were eating, was in the wine we were drinking. Politics was everywhere.
There is a politics that goes through all of Leone's works, that money is and greed are ultimately the things that are pushing people to do all that they do, you know. So you can say they have a touch of Marxism in them.
When the events of May 1968 happened in Paris, with all the student revolutions and everything, all over the shops were, this year, the style is Sergio Leone. Long coats. And the student population of Paris loved Once Upon a Time in the West. They related to it as a movie about American culture. These were the children of Karl Marx and Coca-Cola, right? A mixture of sort of loving America, but also being left-wing. Those were the students of 68, and Leone was the presiding genius.
Leone really isn't as political a director as some of the other spaghetti western directors. He's nowhere near as political or as left-wing as Corbucci or as Damiano Damiani, who made A Bullet for the General. Those are much more overtly political films. I think that there is a political element to Once Upon a Time in the West, more so than the previous films, and it has to do with the railroad.
I know people have asked me if I thought Once Upon a Time in the West was political. I don't see it. It looks like a grand kind of crazy opera, Western opera, in the great Italian tradition of Fellini, who would go off and do these incredible films that I still don't understand, but are beautiful to watch. And I don't see politics in it. I mean, I didn't read it into it. Perhaps you can. I think you could probably read politics into any movie ever made, including Plan 9 from Outer Space. I'm sure there's some in there, too.
After Bertolucci, Argento, and Leone had done their treatment, which was very long, the screenplay was written by Sergio Donati, one of Leone's screenwriters from earlier films, and Leone himself. And Leone wanted to experiment with this rather expansive style of filmmaking. So the script is quite minimal in a way. There isn't much dialogue, but there's a lot of stage directions about the camera moving around and what's going to go on. And clearly, he mispaced himself, because when he was filming the Sweetwater sequence with the massacre of the family, Leone phoned Donati and said, I'm in trouble. Because if I continue, I've got this rhythm, I've got this pace, this strange pace in the movie. It's like in a Japanese film, that you feel the passing of time in a very slow way, very stylish, very slow, and very self-conscious style of filmmaking, very expansive, like a piece of rhetoric almost. And he said, if I continue like this, the film's going to be 5 hours long. I'm in trouble. What can I do? So Donati came down and joined him in Almeria and sat on the set, and they removed various sequences, some of which had already been shot. There's a sequence where Charles Bronson is beaten up by the sheriff, played by Keenan Wynn, and his men, just after the opening sequence at the station, where, if you notice in the finished film, Bronson suddenly appears with a scar on his cheek, and it's never explained. Well, that's the legacy of that sequence, that they immediately cut out. And they also rewrote the script a bit to compress certain bits of it. So, but even so, it was a long movie.
I think that the artistry perhaps has gone over the top and has made the film too long and perhaps too artistic, and that explains perhaps the negative reaction from the studio in the United States and the reason they cut it down so much. They were expecting, you know, a non-stop, wacky, violent entertainment like The Good, the Bad and the Ugly, and instead they got the longest art Western ever made.
At preview in America, it was an absolute disaster. I mean, everyone just thought, in fact, the headline in Time magazine was Tedium in the Tumbleweed. too slow, too long, just goes on forever. So everyone panicked a bit and recut it.
There's something fun about saying, oh, you know, I just saw a version of Once Upon a Time in the West and there was 3 extra minutes. Or, oh, the version I saw, there was missing the scene where Charles Bronson recovers after he gets shot, you know. And so in that sense as well, there's something quite exciting about it. It's a mysterious film that no one's ever quite seen all of it, you know. And so there's always the hope that next time you see it, you'll see a bit more.
And they took out over 20 minutes of material. And of that 20 minutes, there were two big sequences, one in Monument Valley, where they arrive at a wayside inn, and lots of, there's harmonica played by Bronson, there's Robards, and there's the bartender played by Lionel Stander, a Hollywood actor who'd been blacklisted, who's on the credits of the film, but wasn't in the movie first time round, because that sequence was cut. That's one long sequence. And crucially, at the very end, the sequence that was cut for release was the death of Cheyenne. That they ride over the hill, and that's the last you see of them. Whereas in the full version, you know, Cheyenne has been shot by Mr. Morton. They ride over the hill. There's a long scene where Harmonica watches Cheyenne die, puts his body over the horse, and rides off into the end of the romantic bandit, the end of the West. A really sort of downbeat ending. So those two scenes were taken out, and various other bits were pruned to take it down by just over 20 minutes. And it was released in that form. And it wasn't very successful in the States, and it wasn't very successful in England. It was fantastically successful in Paris.
And maybe that's why the film played for those 48 months in one cinema in Paris, because they were kind of proud. This was the only place in the world that you could see Once Upon a Time in the West as Léoné intended. I mean, they are a nation, I think, of cineasts.
The first time I saw Once Upon a Time in the West, I don't remember. I do, you know, think that I'd seen it in such a way that I remembered always having seen it. I don't remember the first time I saw it. I think it was in a theater. But I do remember the way I felt at the end of it, you know, that I felt something big had happened. And I had not had that feeling quite the same as that since seeing The Bridge on River Kwai, where you felt at the end of a movie that you'd participated in some grand event. And, of course, I was a big fan of Léoné, so at the time, the movie was faulted, and then the flaws in it were pointed out and everything. But I knew this movie would last for, you know, forever.
When I saw Once Upon a Time in the West for the first time, I loved it. I remember we saw it at the private projection he had in his house, Sergio. I loved it immediately.
The first time I saw Once Upon a Time in the West, it was at a mega cinema somewhere in Paris. I think a cinema where the film played for 48 months. And I must have seen it there 2 or 3 times. As the print gradually deteriorated and got more and more scratched up, you know, and then the real changes got more and more funky. But I was lucky in that sense, in that the first time I saw Once Upon a Time in the West, it was a fairly complete version.
I first saw Once Upon a Time in the West on its American release here in the United States. I was a film student. I believe it was 1969, if I'm not mistaken. And it was on a double bill with El Dorado, which was a Howard Hawks Western. I was a big fan of Howard Hawks at the time.
I think he gave back to the proper Western makers. I mean, directors from USA, the confidence that a Western can be a great movie. He gave back something that have gone lost, like we said before, the innocence. He gave back a new identity for the Westerners. Something that took off from Monument Valley, went to Almeria in Spain, where Sergio was shooting his movies, and Cinecittà, and goes back to Monument Valley after this kind of little travel to to grow up. So, back to Monument Valley, the Western was a grown-up.
The amazing thing is that for a film that's almost 3 hours long, there's only 15 pages of dialogue. And in that way, it really does resemble the immortal words of John Ford, which is, a film is a great film when it's long on action and short on dialogue.
It actually incorporates every Western that you've ever seen. It's the great anthology of every moment in the Western, but at the same time, it's its funeral dirge. And now, I think, it has a real, real critical and public reputation. You know, in the list of the best films of all time, it comes in the 10 best Westerns, and maybe in the top 50 best movies of all time.
Abbiamo perso un regista importante. Io ho amato molto Sergio perché amava noi attori. E lavorare con Sergio era... era bello. Ti sentivi importante, ti sentivi che avevi creato qualche cosa.
They all said to me, why you don't do another one, another Western like this? Because they love it, this kind of cinema. It's a dream, and cinema is a dream.